Well, when I was asked to give this talk, I was told to make it entertaining. So I'll try. How to cure cancer by surgery in 15 minutes? So here goes.
Summarize it in your own words.
Those were my own words. Well, briefly, I'm proposing that the government should take action to eliminate smoking. Complete ban on all cigarette sponsorship and advertising, even at the point of sale. £50 million to be spent on antisocial publicity. Ban smoking in all public places, and progressive deterrent tax rises over the next 5 years. And a packet of 20 costs about the same as a bottle of whiskey.
Rather drastic.
Absolutely. Reduce smoking by at least 80%. 90% if we're lucky, and drive the tobacco companies out of business.
Yeah. Well, Peter, of course you know I agree with you. Basically, smoking should be stopped.
Okay, he goes on to say, eventually. Eventually, in good time, as usual. And yes, tobacco doesn't feature in today's talks, and it is responsible for 1/3 of cancers. And to put it in perspective, breast cancer kills about 1,000 women in the UK every year, and tobacco, smoking, 120,000, 10 times more. And most people are surprised to get this number. And get that to the rest of the world, it is a significant number. This was in the feature of the front page of the BMJ just 2 weeks ago. And I grew up with this anti-smoking campaign. My father, being a surgeon and a cancer surgeon, showed me how it was devastating families. He told me of the story of a man who he removed the larynx for curing of cancer. This man didn't know how to read or write, and the family shunned him because he couldn't talk. And there was no way for him to communicate with the family. And when I was training in Tata Hospital in Mumbai, 6 of the 10 surgical units were because of tobacco. So tobacco industry causes 1/3 of all cancers. So if you stop growing and selling tobacco, which I'm sure 100 years from now people will wonder how we're doing it now, at a stroke 30% of cancers will not exist and won't be a challenge for the surgeon anymore. So that is the best surgical excision I could do, is to excise tobacco plant from this earth. And it has started happening, thankfully. And the other video was in 1980s. My father got this law passed in Goa. It was called the draconian law by the tobacco industry. There was no sale under the age of 21, and no sale of cigarettes within 20 meters of a temple or a school. And in India, temples are every 21 meters. It's not difficult to. And what he did was he went and spoke to policemen, saying, "You will actually save more lives than what I can do in my lifetime." This law predated other laws in the UK, and this is what happened in the UK in the last 10, 15 years. Smoking has become less popular, it is not cool anymore. Pubs are smoke free now, and it used to be, I never went to a pub when I came to the UK 20 years ago. And it is still 16% of the population smokes, every 6th person, and half of those who smoke will die from it. So that is something which we must do. Right, so that's about tobacco. That's off my chest now. What is cure? A cure is a strange thing. In cancer, it is not, one doesn't say what is cure. And so I thought, why not find a method to say what patients are cured? Normally, when you draw survival curves from cancer, the x-axis shows you the years from diagnosis, and this axis shows you the survival. And patients, when they're told your 5-year survival is 80%, they feel that after 5 years they're going to die. It is very strange, but this is what many people feel. So I changed the x-axis and made it their normal fraction of normal remaining life. So if they live their normal remaining life, these women with cancers which had not spread their lymph nodes, about 70% of them would live their normal remaining life. So they had a personal cure. Now the situation is much better nowadays. And in those days, there was no adjuvant therapy. So these patients were cured by surgery alone. Today, the situation is much better. And for breast cancer, at least 95% patients do as good as they can say they are cured. lot of it is because of overdiagnosis. And this is one of the best graphs you'll see in this talk, is that breast cancer mortality is reducing. And why is this reducing? People suggest it could be because of effect of screening. But if you look at the yellow graph, screening started somewhere in 1989-91. Effect of screening should have happened here. So what happened here? What happened was the Oxford group published a very good overview of all the studies that showed that taking drugs such as tamoxifen and chemotherapy improve survival. And UK started using it much before the rest of the world, so that mortality started falling soon after that. And this is another graph that is interesting, giving us a clue about the biology of breast cancer. These are the incidence of invasive breast cancer in Fife, in Scotland. Now in Fife, a van comes to the village every year, every third year, from January to December. In that year, you find from 100 per 100,000, the number of cancers goes up to 150. You would expect these cancers have been detected early, and therefore in the following year, the cancers would be reduced. They don't reduce, they remain the same. So where were all these cancers doing before we started screening? Nobody allowed this to be published. It's published in the BMJ as a letter. The chair of the ISD Scotland, who gave me this data, said that we'll have to stop screening if this gets published and widely publicized. So there is something called as overdiagnosis by screening, in which we are finding cancers which may never grow. And this is a recurring theme in many cancers. So trying to find every cancer too early, maybe too early, and surgery ideally works, and no solid tumor up to now in adults very rarely has been treated within the body, as said by one of my mentors, Professor Mitra. So most solid tumors need to be surgically excised, and people have used various methods to do these surgical excisions, and these are rather barbaric methods, but they were surgical methods, and we used to do radical mastectomies, which led to a lot of disfigurement, because the idea was to remove the cancer from its roots. But we can do better now. You don't have to do a radical mastectomy, because we know that if you give adjuvant radiotherapy, it works. And we can remove quite large number of size cancers in the breast, and that patient has had about 2-inch cancer removed without showing much difference from the other side. And so surgery has got better. We are doing less surgery for cancer. We are doing more precise surgery for lymph nodes. We are giving more targeted radiotherapy. And we are using new biological agents to target things better. I was asked to speak on the Da Vinci robot and the robotics in surgery, which can do something like this. It's very impressive, rather slow, as you may say. And yes, it is stitching a great skin very nicely. Unfortunately, randomized trials that have compared robotic surgery with conventional surgery haven't been able to show a better cancer outcome. So it's interesting, it's better. Sometimes some functional outcomes are better, but as such, it has not improved cancer outcomes, unfortunately. And 3D reconstruction surgery is... That's my time.
Look at the tumor.
Teresa's surgery needs meticulous planning. Surgical simulation expert Hitesh Koria uses groundbreaking technology to turn CT scans into an exact 3D replica of Teresa's skull with the tumor shown in pink.
That shows it well, doesn't it? You've got to take the eye to try and ensure as much as possible that we've got the cancer out.
Sure. So if I take that away,
you're
left with that.
Perfect. That shows that we're actually clear of the cancer.
So these methods can be used to direct, to precisely remove the cancer. We use it in breast surgery using radioactivity and wires to localize the cancer and remove it. When I was learning to treat cancer back in India, what I found is that the women had to have breast cancer treated, they had to stay in Bombay for 6 weeks. And if they didn't stay in Bombay, they had to have a mastectomy in order, because if they had to have breast cancer, they needed radiotherapy to the whole breast. So the lab work which I had done at that time suggested that breast cancer, although it is present in many parts of the breast, these other areas don't grow as much as what could grow around the tumor. So if breast cancer recurs around the tumor, why not focus radiotherapy only around the tumor? And when I came to UK, we developed a new technique based on this insight and tested whether this works or not in a randomized clinical trial. So this is a technique in which you insert a spherical applicator after having removed the lump to radiate the tissue immediately surrounding the cancer, targeting those areas where the recurrence could occur. And this was one of the slides 20 years ago now, this is Professor Baum. And now this treatment is used in about 350 centers around the world as standard of care. So this randomized trial went on for about 12 years in which we compared these two treatments in a randomized fashion. It was one trial with 1 million data feeds. And we recruited for about 12 years, and when we found the answer was that, what is the chance of my living without a cancer coming back? And that answer is that it is very similar in the two groups, except that in one group, all the treatment is completed in the operation theater. So you have a lumpectomy and radiotherapy during surgery, compared with lumpectomy followed by radiation every day for 3 to 6 weeks. The interesting point here is that we found there were fewer non-breast cancer deaths. Why could that be? It might be because radiotherapy has been known to irradiate the heart and the lungs and other organs, and that could cause cancers, that could kill people. When breast cancer on its own is not having a mortality of more than 4 or 5%, this increased mortality because of cardiac or other cancers becomes important. And we have confirmed in a meta-analysis that when you target radiotherapy around the tumor, there is an overall survival benefit of about 1 or 2%. But surgery is not just a mechanical tool, it's a biological intervention. What happens is, when you operate, it induces inflammation. And this inflammation, as is one way of saying it, it may induce many other things. There is a peak hazard of recurrence that occurs about 1 to 2 years after surgery, and this is not explained by anything other than suggestion that surgery probably stimulates these metastatic disease. When you have more information around surgery, for example, reconstruction, this peak appears to appear after the reconstruction site. When you have a complication after a reconstruction, in this diagram you can see the yellow blue line is those patients without complications, and the red line is those with complication, you find that it reduces the disease-free survival. So we tested this in an experiment in patients who had a lumpectomy. These patients had their wound fluid collected, and we found this fluid stimulated cancer cells in the lab. And if we collected wound fluid from patients who had intraoperative radiotherapy, this stimulation of cancer cells by the fluid from the patient's wound did not happen. So we had a surprise that by giving radiotherapy, what we're doing is, these are cancer cells in normal wound fluid, and these are cancer cells when they have come out of a patient who have had intraoperative radiotherapy. So this intraoperative radiotherapy seems to have an effect through change of various proteins in the wound fluid to inhibit what stimulation the wounding might have in that patient. And patients who have had intraoperative plus whole breast radiotherapy seem to have a very low recurrence rate. And maybe this is because of that. The most interesting part in that was this group, in which patients who had both treatments compared with whole breast radiotherapy, they seem to have very few deaths from heart attacks and other cancers. This cannot be explained because of a bad effect of whole breast radiotherapy being avoided. There might be some beneficial effect of giving intraoperative radiotherapy. And we find this is true when in other studies where we have given intraoperative radiotherapy plus whole breast radiotherapy. So inflammation in cancer, as the previous speaker has said, might be very important. And there is a trial that is testing this, because they found that anybody who was taking non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs around the operations for solid tumors had reduced mortality compared to those who did not. So there's a trial that is testing this in Belgium, run by an anesthetist who noticed this phenomenon, Patrice Forget. So I would like to end there by saying, how do we cure cancer with surgery? Surgery, together with radiotherapy and drugs, could reduce its potential harmful effects. So we can do more precise surgery, less mutilating surgery, and combine it with radiotherapy or other mechanisms to try and reduce its harmful effects on causing other cancer cells from growing. and ultimately, hopefully, not have any surgery at all. Thank you.